Listen, can I get your attention? I know it's been a long time, but so I try to be brief. Rom? First of all, I would like to thank Nikki for finding me in my oblivion in Oxford and getting me back here, albeit for a short time. And also my most sincere thanks to Arletta Ford, who got me out of Alma years and years ago. So with that, I think I can start. What I'm going to talk today is something which came to my attention over the last few years. And this is what are the commonalities between very, very different areas. And you can see them here, and outline of my talk is simple. It's just a key point. The three different domains have in common, and those are Zen practice, neuroscience, and actually I'm only touching on Nishida's work. It, for reasons which will become clear why. And of course there are always a lot of open questions. And that actually, well, I was quite excited being invited here because I welcome open questions. I'm full of doubt and there are no certainties in this area, and it's much more interesting for me to get your doubts rather than saying, ah yeah, this is really like that. So let's see what we can come up with. So this Venn diagram is something that really made it for me when I was preparing presentation for the Japanese Association of the Promotion of Science. So why it is important? Neuroscience, this is really the thing of the maybe last 20 or 30 years. I think it brings great promise, but also dangers, and one of the dangers I see in it is danger of oversimplification. By training, I'm an experimental physicist. So I naturally doubt anybody's experiment that I cannot repeat, or if I haven't witnessed myself, if I don't understand the method, if I don't understand the analysis. And I'm most doubtful if somebody tells me that it fits a particular model perfectly. There is not such a thing. Every physical phenomena that we can measure can be explained by different models. Some of them are more convincing, some of them are less convincing. And you will see in what I'm going to mention about neuroscience that there are things which are interesting, but they are far from being certain. And that actually impacts on the way we teach mindfulness and meditation. So what are the commonalities within this Venn diagram? And everything changes. This is the essence of the Buddhist teaching, but it's also the essence of what ancient Greeks were saying already, and that's what modern physics tells us, that everything is in motion, nothing is ever stable. I mean, you see me now, I was once a little girl, although it's hard to remember that, and the molecules in my body have changed, they were expelled every 7 years or so, I was in principle a new person. So also my psyche hopefully was changing, my emotions didn't remain the same. So am I really this little girl which was born X year ago in a remote place in Poland? I don't know. So let's try to find some answers to that. And what is in it that actually Zen, the essence of Zen, we go a little bit into that, is that we have to transcend realistic thinking in order to be able to answer this question. And in neuroscience, the main point that we are making is that the brain has the property of neuroplasticity, which allows us to learn, which allows to stay alive. Some of us have brains which are more neuroplastic than others, but that's life. And in philosophy, in this particular branch of philosophy, I'm really sort of most worried here because I'm not a philosopher. And if you look into Western philosophy, you have tomes and volumes about the self, what we are, who we are. But in the Eastern philosophy that I'm going to touch on, there is no such thing as static self. It cannot be. And the concept of self becomes very diffused and almost intangible. So my question is, how on earth can we measure something which has no existence? There are ways to try to approach that. Now, what is Zen? I will invite you to make your own definition or tell me what you think, but an applied life philosophy is one thing. The other is something like obscure and suspect religion, which was lifted from the East. Another way is that a minimalistic approach to art, life and poetry, design, yes. Being happy without reason. And actually, in the context of our discussion, I find most important the definition that it is dialectic pragmatism with a religious basis. And this comes from a really excellent book of essays by Lisa Living Zen. This is probably the only book which you ever need to read, despite of volumes written about that. And why dialectic? It is really important because Zen questions everything. I cannot accept anything without experiencing it. There is nothing given on faith. That's why it's also said sometimes that Zen is transmission without words, which is not completely true. The monks have to study sutras, but that's a little bit beside the point. And pragmatism, because it's very practical, it's based in the daily life. It's how we live our life now, not sometime in the future, and not how we lived it in the past. We always start from every moment as it is. And religious basis, because it does accept that there is something greater than us, of which we are part. And how we connect to that, actually Zen doesn't give you prescription. Because people who come to Zen come from all paths, being it agnostic, being it atheist, being it Catholic, it doesn't matter. There is something bigger than that. It goes to the root of who we are and where we are in the universe. And it is experiential, purely experiential. There is something people can tell you, but there is Zen theory. Yeah, but it's not being taught in a sense of I give you a lecture on Zen theory. You have to come and practice and sit with me, and then we can sort of get into what is called Zen theory. But from the experiential point of view, what is very important, there is no soul. We have body-mind. So still body means still mind. Still mind, we mean still body. So if you see me twitching in my chair, you know that my mind is all over the place. Yeah? What I wanted to do before we get further, because we are going to talk about how to measure meditation, is to have a very short experiment that you experience what meditation, which is tested, is about. So if you just sit in your chair, let me demonstrate it. It's only a couple of minutes that we need. So just sit comfortably in your chair, but make sure that your spine is straight. And plant your feet on the ground. You can put your hands on your thighs. Yeah, so it can be sometimes painful to straighten your spine, but you won't suffer for long. You can put your hands in your lap like that, or just put them on. And drop your eyesight, or you can close your eyes if you want, defocus your eyes, and start breathing deeply from the belly. You can feel how your body realigns, how your internal organs find space. And now, to focus your attention, I ask you to count your incoming and outgoing breaths. One on the incoming, two on outgoing, three in, four out. Count up to 10 and then go back to 1. If you lose your count, go back to 1. And that's all what we will do for the next couple of minutes. gently sway your body side to side and come back to this moment. Now, how easy was it for you to keep calm without being interrupted by your thoughts?
Very.
Was it okay? Did you notice any thoughts coming?
Yes.
So this is something which is at the basis of many meditative techniques, that we are aware of the thoughts, but we don't suppress them, we just ignore them. And this simple exercise is one of the very beginning that every beginner who comes to learn meditation gets. It's just keeping your attention where you want it. And of course, in the course of day, we know we have straight thoughts even if we concentrate on any given problem. So the art is just to realize it and come back. Come back 100 times if necessary. That's how we learn how to focus and sharpen attention. There are other techniques later, we drop the count and so forth and so forth. But the basis remains the same. And now you can imagine how neuroscience tries to measure what is happening in our brain during the similar exercise like we just undergone. Yeah? And influences on the various parts of the brain. As a physicist, I think in terms of parameters. In this room, we had many parameters which you were aware or not aware of. It was quite silent, which is nice, but some of you might have been disturbed by the sound of projector noise, the sound of your internal thoughts, yes? Or maybe your belly was saying, right, she's going on, but the lunch is waiting, yeah? Who knows? Temperature of the room, which may be or not may be comfortable for you. So it is extremely difficult to establish experimental conditions which would be reproducible and which in which every individual would react in a similar way, let alone identical way. And I can assure you that I have more than 3 decades of meditation experience. There is not a single meditation which repeats itself. Every time it is different. Every single time you can get into similar state but never identical. You can never reproduce. And now you start to think, okay, how can you compare experiences of different individuals? It gets even harder. Yeah? And so how we can measure the influence of mindfulness on the brain? And my personal viewpoint is that human is a body-mind, that's nothing really new, look at the whole Buddhist theory, it is a body-mind. But as a physicist, I see it as the soup of moving Coulomb charges. And that's where it really gets interesting for a physicist, because what does it mean to focus attention? It means that there is some reorganization going on that in the language of my predecessor here, we get some coherent domains in our mind, in our brain, because mind is not the same as a brain, obviously. So, that how can we measure that? There are techniques which can measure that, like the first measurements were done by using electroencephalography. We know about brain waves and so. Then the functional magnetic resonance image came on. And that's something which I can say a little bit more about because my PhD was in nuclear magnetic resonance, which is the predecessor of this technique. But if you look how people who are in the meditative states or induced meditative states are being examined by functional MRI, you are sort of breathing into a very large magnet. There is a lot of noise going on. There is a lot of movement going on. So to keep your concentration is extremely difficult. And obviously, the simple way is, okay, give a body an impulse. You can measure response in the brain. But it's all model, it's an interpretation of what is happening, because during the taking of MRI images, you get certain areas of the brain which sort of light up, as they say, and the other not. But how do we know that it was just this particular meditative state? I don't know. I wouldn't be able to say from my own practice. And all these type of experiments have support from the psychology. But in psychology, the evaluation of self-questionnaire leads to one great problem. I mean, how often do we cheat ourselves? Our doctor, you go to your doctor, do you exercise? Yeah, I do exercise a lot. And that means going from the kitchen to the couch and switching on the TV, yes. I'm really exaggerating to make the point. I'm not doing anything personal, but I think you are couch potatoes, please. So, this is,
just a quick question. I mean, in the fMRI, is there any suggestion that you can pick up general things about meditative states in the fMRI? I mean, is there any commonality? Have people done experiments on people who routinely meditate and they can try and...
Yes, and, I come to that. Yes, but good that you mentioned that, because people will try to focus on a given area of the brain and say this part of the brain is responsible for responding to this particular impulse. And I will disprove that as well by the research done by others. How does it work? Very simple. We have about 90 billion neurons forming the brain network. So I mean, as a physicist, I start to already worry. I think I write statistical physics somewhere, yes, and average, because I can't follow any particular impulse in this mass of neurons. And we know that we have synapses which actually allow us to get the electrical signal conducted to the axon, and then we have a lot of connections, and actually each of these neurons receives a lot of signals, and there is a very quick response time in sort of milliseconds. And also it's either excite or inhibit. So it's almost like 0-1 gate. You either excite or inhibit neuron. So far I haven't come across the statement which would say there are fuzzy logic states in it, that there can be either that or that. It may exist or not, but the information goes. And this is the first important point that I started to understand what it means. Because there is no way that you can get response from a single neuron. No way. You need many of them in order to have the signal which is detectable. Yeah? It's a principle of every spectroscopic technique that you need a lot of impulses which are sort of coherent or reasonably coherent to get a response of the system.
Could I raise a question on that?
Yeah.
Does that not stand for when you're trying to form the basis of your classification on an exterior world? In fact, if you close down closer to a set of neurons or one neuron, then that's no longer true. In fact, it will have a deterministic behavior. So it's a question of the class of comparison you're making, isn't it?
Maybe, yeah.
Okay.
I haven't really talked in those terms, frankly speaking, but that's a very good point. Okay, now neuroplasticity, that was again something which sort of eluded me for a while to understand it, because you may know that years and years ago, some century ago, there was a theory that we learn everything until the age of 18 and then we are formed and nothing happens. And obviously we missed the very big point, how can we learn? And then there came the next stage of the neuroplasticity theory that brain has this property that we can reshape neuronal paths, however we define them, whether it's single neuron or many neuronal paths close together. And now came the third theory, which makes even more sense to me, because we have something like two stages. The first one is the forming of the whole structure, and the second, which is sort of more permanent, which is more stable. And then the second one is the neural network, which responds on the minute-by-minute basis. And how they are connected, they don't say, but you can think the explanation in terms of experiences of people who undergo meditation practice. They would, after, say, a week-long meditation exercise, people find that some things have changed. They may be happier, they may be more alive, they may be more creative. But if they don't continue, that will decay. Yes, it will be gone. So it was a momentary effect, this change of state. But change of trait happens if they continue, because then the whole overarching structure can undergo certain changes. So that would explain this neuroplasticity of the brain model, would explain how we can both learn and over the long period of time change our psyche, or whatever psyche is. I mean, don't ask me to define psyche. So, but we need to go a little bit deeper what we can measure, because if things are not measurable, they are very interesting and nice, and we can talk about in terms of philosophy. Oh, enjoy your meal. She's eating something. So, I mean, you may know that nowadays mindfulness is really a new black. Everybody's talking in terms of mindfulness, how great it is. I mean, if you are unhappy for whichever reason, if you are addicted, if you need to lose weight, whatever, just take mindfulness course, preferably for 8 weeks, preferably with sort of cognitive therapy, and you are cured forever and of all. Now, I can tell you that it is really not true. It may work, it doesn't necessarily work. It's a very good practice, but we need to know how to handle it. And one of the main problems for those of you, I haven't said yet, I'm Zen teacher. So for us, and I'm lay Zen teacher, for us, the main problem is the blind belief and sort of selling this mindfulness, which is completely detached from its Buddhist roots. And that is truly in the Buddhist tradition. What you have the Eightfold Path, which is rightful thinking, rightful speech, rightful action, and then on top of it, as the number eight, sits mindfulness. So you work it through really a complex moral system. I don't like to say religious, because moral and ethical is much more in that. So when you detach it from the roots, mindfulness becomes something like sort of learning how to be more effective. That's what stays, how to be more effective in writing more papers, how to be effective in producing better weapons so they can kill more people. Anything can be there. And that can do in itself a lot of harm, because it serves no purpose. It doesn't serve in improving your relationship with your neighbor. It doesn't serve in improving the state of the world. It doesn't improve the fact that we need to, desperately, that we need to care for the natural world, which is disappearing at alarming speed. So, I have undergone training in Japan, but also here, and we live in the Western world. I'm the Westerner. And I need to find a way how to take the basic values, basic in the sense of fundamental, not trivial, and couple them to our modern life. And actually psychology and psychotherapy is very helpful here. The modern approach needs to couple the sort of old-fashioned, very pared-down techniques with something which helps the modern man who is under influence, modern lay person, who is under influence of so many conflicting requirements and possibly has family, has responsibilities in the society, how to live a better life. So that's the mind. And how does it relate to the processes in the brain? And what is measured and what can be measured? Okay, so there are again different models, and if you dip your toe in the literature on the subject, you will find that there is no agreement between the scientists who measure mindfulness, because there are also very many meditation techniques, and they will have different influence on the brain. So simply, I actually quite like this model. What mindfulness meditation means: you have three components, which is attention control, emotion regulation, and self-awareness. And now attention control can be measured. There are lots of psychologists who love these experiments on people in front of the computer screen, or people who are being sort of branded with some hot stuff and their reactions measured, which is quite fun. And so that's what can be measured. Emotional regulation, I think, is much harder to measure. So physical impulses can be measured, but they are all three components which bring self-regulation. And then what happens, you can look at it for practitioners, lots of people who were tested are long-term practitioners. So and some which were in early stages. So what can be said about it? That in the early stage, everything takes an effort. It takes an effort to sit still. It takes an effort not to walk out in the middle of meditation. It takes an effort just to listen. So in the middle stage, we just make effort to reduce the mind wandering, which you might or might not experience during these few minutes that we have silently together. I mean, that's my everyday job. Every day I wake up and for a while everything is silent, and then my mind starts to make its, as the Indians say, the mind is like the drunken monkey bitten by the spider. So that's the very apt description as far as I'm concerned. In advanced stage that all Zen practitioners aspire to, we have just a thoughtless being. So we just are. We do what needs to be done without worry, without bother, without any effort. And so how does it look like in terms of measuring something? And in the paper that I'm preparing for ANPA, I will aim to give a sort of very short review of, it's like a meta review of the current literature, because there are lots of reviews, so I will do very simple meta review and a couple of examples worked out that you can see what really, where really are changes. So in the brain structure, now again, one thing, you have to be aware that the sample sizes of people investigated, they are very small, they are intense. Yeah? So now my question is again, how can I draw conclusion from a small sample and project it on 7 billion people? Mm. That's the problem we have here, yes? Mm. My colleagues who do neuroscience, they hate me saying that, because I come and tell them, look, it's a model, your model is very nice, but even in statistical terms, you don't have central limit theorem because you need at least 20 people.
Yeah. Well, but why are people
I'm not really popular.
Why are people so frightened?
No, no, I'm not really popular, so with certain people. But you can see that from some investigations, we have, for example, the key areas which are affected in Zen meditation. The first one was that in some Zen practitioners, the gray matter volume is thicker than in non-practitioners, and also it is less age-related related decline. Now, it is not completely true because my teacher, Shinzan Miyamae Roshi, he suffers from dementia, so this is not, and he's a Zen master, one of the more powerful masters in Japan, so, you know, don't take it on the face value. And cortical thickness, and you can see which one regulates it. And again, the M is meditator sample 13, C is control, M17 meditation sample C control. And so you can see which regions of the brain are involved in there. And one of the things I do not have much time to go into is that we have the limbic brain, which drives us very strongly. And actually, during meditation, what we do, consciously or subconsciously, we fight with the impulses which come to the limbic brain. And that's why limbic brain, this is the primitive brain that we share with all lizards. And then the rest is sort of the brain of the modern man. But our emotions and reactions sit in the limbic brain. So there is this disparity already here between trying to rehearse emotions which are almost non-rehearsable because they are instinctive. So that's why it is so hard to sit still, even for a minute, because you think, well, who is behind my back? So this is, I just wanted to sum up promise and challenge of neuroscience and impulses that influence particular parts of the brain. I will still comment on it in a second. It's almost impossible to select one quantity or parameter, and actually brain is a very complex network, and how meaningful it is isolate one part of it. How does it really make sense? And my point is also how reproducible are the paths. How can we make sure, are we sure that over the times of practice when we change our habits, we change the same path and not make a new one and forget about the old one? Nobody answered the question yet. And differences between meditation techniques, this is a problem with benchmarking, because it's almost impossible to truly compare results from different investigations, and problems in psychological self-assessment. Now, there is one really beautiful experiment which shows that the pain of social rejection, which is emotional pain, is like a physical pain. The brain cannot distinguish. The parts of the brain which reacts to physical pain and emotional pain overlap. So that's why we talk in terms of a broken heart. That's why the social rejection, emotional rejections, feels like a physical pain. The brain doesn't know. It's the same for it. And I have articles with me. I'm happy to leave the copies. And I'm happy to discuss it more in detail. But that was something which Anwan had told me validated the Zen practice, because in Zen practice we take everything into our body. We work things to our bodies, not to our minds. On the other hand, it disproved what neuroscience is saying now. There is no unique assignment of emotions to the parts of the brain, or thoughts to the parts of the brain, not as yet. Now, I came up with a simple model. how can we talk about meditative states? Because it's, I'm sure you know about Lorentz attractor, and I'm not trying to make any mathematics here. But I just realized that every time we start meditation, we start from something which is different, but it has to be close enough that it gets us to the meditative state. So what if I think of meditative state, a particular meditative state, as a Lorentz attractor? And then I get several paths which are around it and get me there. And I was happy. That's I think the way it's, and please, it's not description of reality, it's just a very simple model. That I thought brings together the meditative states and sort of description of our physical, because the lines are our physical and mental state. And in the middle, the true meditative state, when you drop your body, drop your mind, is like a black hole. Nothing is there until you come out of it. So that's the... Yeah. Moving on to philosophy, I have still a few minutes. Is trying, yes?
Well, I just had a quick question. I don't know if I should have
asked.
You were talking about social interaction and social rejection. And you mentioned that you started the talk off talking about are you still the little girl that you were when you were, if your body is physically changing. My question is, if your body is physically changing and you're not physically the same cells, how do you maintain a self-identity? Is it from social interaction with other people, that people see you and they say you're Sydney or you're Barbara and we know you as your identity of Barbara? Or is it something that stays constant with you through time through social interaction?
Extremely good question.
Because your body's physically different, you're not physically the same person.
This is very, very valid question,
How do you call that ego? Your social interaction with yourself in terms of society is ego. It's just a picture that you paint. Nobody is a true self in terms of it. And basically, I experienced this by a good friend who I know since childhood, where our ways parted when we came together. My interaction with him was completely honest, which wasn't when I was interacting with other people. There was always a show with other people.
Okay, now we can find some answer.
Could I add a point to the end of the last part you were saying about the movement into meditation? And my background is more in the Theravadin sort of area. And rather than saying coming back to the thing that you are looking at, they tend to say watch the arising of a thought and then gently set it aside without being angry with yourself over the fact that it's disturbing you. That repeated process of letting the mind move forward and then gently sliding away is slightly different from going back to where you thought you were. Sort of.
This is just the richness of meditation techniques. I only embark on something that I know and experience, because if you think about Tibetan Buddhism, it's incredibly beautiful and incredibly rich, but it involves completely different parts of awareness.
The thing is, it's slightly more abstract. It takes you away from whatever it is.
How we get into particular meditative states, it's very much the way we are taught and then what we find ourselves. So it's perfectly valid point. Now, coming to Sydney's question, is something that is actually quite nice, because in Buddhism we have the five aggregate model. What we are formed of are five called aggregates, which are formed when we are born, and when we die, they fall apart. And then they recombine and form other five aggregates. And those five aggregates, at the time they are together, they are being, and for convenience, they are called Barbara, or Sydney, or Garnet, or whoever. That's what we in the West call ego. That's what forms together something that we are. We perceive ourselves as, and perceive as by others as. Can you imagine all the time being non-named five aggregates? That doesn't really work, does it? But in this sense, the aggregate has a material form, feelings, perception, volition, and sensory consciousness. So it's really quite a neat description, and it's again a model, it's a theory. And actually, sensory consciousness is being conscious of something, and that's something which can be investigated, yeah? Being conscious of something like, you kick me, I feel it, I'm conscious of that. And so, knowing sensory stimulus, which can be visual, tactile, olfactory, auditory, or taste, or a thought, which is the concern with past, present, or future. There is a lovely little article by Karunami, which actually looks into that in the link between this Buddhist theory of five aggregates and the mindfulness and neuroscience. I wanted to finish by talking very little about philosophy of Kitaro Nishida. If you have ever heard of him, it might have been in context of Japanese nationalism. I'm afraid the same thing happened to him that happened to Nietzsche with fascism. Part of his philosophy was pinched and hijacked, yes, and completely thwarted for the purposes of the Japanese nationalism. You can see he died in 1945. But why I'm interested in it for two reasons. One was that my Zen teacher, he's been extremely keen on making more clear the links between Zen and the philosophy of Nishida. And the other, when I started to go into it, I realized that he was really a very exceptional person. Because until he sort of appeared in Japan, there was no philosophy in the Western meaning in Japan, because you have to think that in 18th century, in the West, there was a separation of logic and religion, which then logic made philosophy and religion stayed religion. But in Japan and China, in the Buddhist thought, there is no separation. Mm. Philosophy is religion. Mm. Whether some components are sort of brought up as ethics or so, but it remains the fact.
So they didn't go to that social evolution and invested?
No, that's one of the reasons why it didn't happen. But what Nishida did, it was really remarkable, because he studied Western philosophers and he formed his own system, which is neither Western philosophy nor Eastern philosophy. It's the I call his approach a fuzzy logic. So he combined this fuzzy logic of the East with the disciplined approach of the West.
So you can just transcend those binaries.
Yes, exactly. And so his central two concepts, which are relevant for our discussion, is one of absolute nothingness, and that is when we go into meditation, we become. Through meditation, we become absolute nothingness for a little while. And also the other thing which links him to Western philosophy is direct experience. And this is state prior to subject-object distinction and prior to any subsequent cognitional analysis. And some of you who knew David Bohm or were familiar with his dialogues knew that in the dialogues with Krishnamurti he was talking about ground. Now, this is the same thing. And in the teachings of Zen Master Bankei, we have unknown mind.
What was that last one you said? You were talking about ground?
Ground. Ground. I mean, as a physicist, I translated into ground state, and this is the state called unborn or whatever, in which is prior to any thoughts arising. Yes. So as soon as the thought arises, there is existence. And obviously, it is something which is very pretty hard to take on in our daily life, because I do exist as a physical person. Yes. But it's a matter of perception much more than a reality of physical existence. And What links him to the West is pure experience. Now, the great philosopher James had this idea that the first thing we do, we experience something. And then in the second moment, we cognize, oh, that's something that I experienced. In the third moment, we analyze, oh, this was a pleasant, unpleasant experience. And so the basis of Nishida's philosophy and also the basis of Zen practice is to get down to this first pure experience, to this very first moment before we cognize. And that's obviously not... I think I said enough, because any further explanation only diffuses the matter. It's truly a matter of practice, of experience with yourself. Only you know how the tea tastes, whether it's hot or cold. Only I know whether I'm cold or hot at the moment. You don't know it. So, I think we can finish. I'm okay on time?
Yeah?
Good. With open questions. So, and questions are not just to me, but to everybody. Can the self-awareness be a reliable measure? And also whether we can unify the philosophical thought and activity so that the one view of the world can inform one's acting in the world. I mean, this is a very big question, and this is for everybody, and not just for us as individuals, but also for the society. This is, can neuroscience influence philosophy, and can philosophy influence neuroscience? And then also, can progress in experimental science inform Buddhism? This change the fundamentals. And actually, the Dalai Lama is very busy with that since 1990s. And he's one of the very few religious leaders who said, if the science tells me that that a particular theory in Buddhism is wrong, we change the theory. Yeah, I mean, it's truly, absolutely, absolutely mind-boggling, his attitude. And I just would like to express gratitude to my teacher, Shivanya Roshi, and I thank you for your attention. And yes.
I want to ask about variables.
Yes.
Because you talked about the sort of the eating kind of measurements and that kind of thing. And yeah, there is a problem in identifying and counting variables.
Yeah.
And I wonder, you know, this is where we start from Western science.
Mm-hmm.
And we make all sorts of assumptions about the world.
Yeah.
In that very act of counting, yes, we see this signal here, and this signal is the same category as this signal.
Could we have one thing at a time, please? Tony, could we... We've got some minutes. Can we just sort of do that and then do that afterwards?
Okay.
Please, thank you.
I was just asking about the whole problem of variables and measurement, really.
Mm-hmm.
And so when you get someone into an EEG machine and you identify the parameters you're going to be counting, you identify the occurrences of those things that you're counting, you take your measurements.
Yeah.
And this is a problem we have everywhere. I mean, even, you know, doing information theory, it's counting.
Yeah.
How do you reconcile the problem of counting with this inherent instability of the self, the assumed instability of the world? That those assumptions that we make about variable X being the same as variable Y,
yeah,
are made in us.
Sure.
And somehow we find a way of agreeing about those assumptions, but it doesn't seem to. It doesn't add up.
Yeah, I know.
It's not commensurate.
Yes.
Yeah, I know.
Isn't one answer that you have to always be aware of what you did,
yes,
in the act of counting?
Absolutely.
Or observing?
Yes.
Yeah.
So you have to be as aware as possible, and that requires an enormous
Yeah.
Well, that's also the problem of what is called intersubjectivity.
Absolutely. Yes. Well, that was the other thing I was going to mention, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I wanted to try to connect three things. The example of the kind of Zen that you are helping us to see more clearly is, I had a friend, I had in Japan who is the head of a school, and most of his time goes to counseling troubled teenagers. And he said, I have one after another of these troubled teenagers who each have problems that they have to deal with that are a really big deal in their life. And he said, in order for me to be fair to each of them, I have to efficiently clear my mind in like a minute's time after the last one left before I start the next one. And that gave me, I mean, I could understand that, and that really captured something about what was important in all of this. And the second item I wanted to mention was that the tradition of professional go masters grew out of the Buddhist tradition. And so imagine a military leader and a religious leader who is able to change his mind in an important way. So there was a general who prided himself on being sort of a master of strategy and so on. And he, as a go player, he was better at it than anyone else he knew until he met this Buddhist leader who could let him start with 5 moves first, still win. Well, he got all excited about this. He went to the shogun and the emperor and convinced them that this is an important thing for us to pay attention to, and so they decided to, for the government of Japan, to fund four Go colleges. And that was, I think, 1612 or something like that, AD. And the first great leader of leader, I think not quite in the same exact tradition. But anyway, I don't know that the two of them ever had a chance to meet. They were contemporary, and they were, it was a couple hundred years before there was another Go-Master at a level like they were. And so now then, having said, those two things. So, neuroscience is going through a revolution right now in connection with the AI of AlphaGo. We knew that if they were able to complement, or if they were able, I should say, to take the certain particular concepts from neuroscience, that they'd be able to make progress with things like Go-playing programs. By the way, there had been a proof by Minsky that it was impossible with neural nets to do such things, but it turned out his proof was only about single layer neural nets. And you needed more layers. And lots more layers. And the thing is, then you have also the distinction between the kind of short-term processes that then have to get mapped into the longer-term things. And the relationship between I would like to have a better understanding, and I think a lot of people would, of how the thing I started with first was the counselor helping the troubled teenager, his moment of clearing his mind efficiently before before addressing the problems of the next kid. How I'd like to have a better understanding of how that relates to both the importance for being a strong Go player and the relationship of those things to the neurophysiology that's made possible the incredible breakthrough that they've made in the past couple of years.
Right. Can I just give a very quick comment on the comment? You raised extremely important point. How do you tune into mind of somebody's? Because that's what this master was doing. He was tuning into every troubled teenager. So, but then you have completely let go of this particular person and tune into the next one. And that's something we can learn. That's a technique. That's part of the training that you learn. You must let go and go on to the next thing without dragging on the rest. And I'm not sure what processes in the brain are responsible for letting go. And also, one of the things which always made me interested in these investigations is when you have one-to-one interview with the student, it doesn't matter whether you're a master or student, you have to be reasonably close. It's called sansen odokusan. You have to be reasonably close to each other. And at some point there is something like a resonance, which is invisible but tangible. It is something like your mind is sort of focused and sharp, and if it's a true student, you resonate with the student. If it's not a true student, or somebody sort of relaxed, then you don't resonate. And that is something which actually goes to me. I see it as the play of force fields. That's where we know we have the. Maybe there is a mega attunement of the electromagnetic currents in the brain which produce like laser-like wave, okay? That's one of the things. So that's one thing on the physical level. On the psychological level, you really have to learn how to let go of what was before. I'm not sure whether I fully answered the question, but...
I just want to say, can I just point out a potential problem that might be behind assumptions? Behind variables and measurements, I wrote it down. The statement one equals one and one plus one equals two, that doesn't seem to kind of, what that seems says to me is that copies are like a convenient fiction.
Mm-hmm.
And then you're talking about trying to trace a neuron's path, network pathway, mm-hmm. and following an individual pathway. There seems to be a big gap between copies in the way we start arithmetic and based on our measurements and trying to follow individual particular pathways.
That was my criticism of this way of thinking. I don't think that way. Yes?
I have a quote comment.
Of the answers.
In the book
of Prigozhin, there is an example. They measured the potential difference in the brains. If the person didn't sleep, the potential became stochastic.
И что было похоже, как будто бы он описывается уравнением со
странным
аттрактором.
Если
человек спал,
что
это оказался циклический
был.
Если человек сумасшедший,
mental problems, it was also cyclical.
That was another thing I wanted to say, that at some level it may not be distinguishable whether there are mental problems or elevated meditation states. It is very well known that through certain stages of practice you do need to go with a teacher because you simply can't go mad. There are things which are exploding and they can be illusory, they can be pretty real. And if you don't have teacher at that point, and I know somebody who was very accomplished monk and he got mad because he got into very, very elevated meditational states, but that sort of took him into the abyss. So be aware, meditation is not a cure for all. It's not, despite of what you read in literature, it's truly very difficult to work with people with depression, but much more difficult and much more dangerous with people who have diseases of the self, like paranoia or schizophrenia. The meditation can make it much worse, much worse. So that's the meditational experiences and states are life in roses. There are lots of thorns there as well. And that's what makes it real.
I'm so glad you said that, because I know a lot of people have mental health
conditions,
and they should not go anywhere near meditating
things. Yeah. I mean, I run the courses for Oxford University. It's actually in 2012, I and then my Zen master were talking about it at Antwerp, And the article that we did publish in ALPA is now on ResearchGate, and it has almost 1,000 of readings and downloads. So you can see there is quite interest in the scientific community. But yes, and when I teach, I demand that people declare whether they have mental conditions, and if they have mental conditions, I say, I'm sorry, I can't take you. You need much more specialized treatment, because it is so dangerous. It's this is really for specialists to help people with meditation while they have mental problems. And as I say, in some cases I wouldn't advise it at all. Okay, I think it's lunchtime.
Can we restart?